Questions?
Could you elaborate a little more on what you were saying in the beginning about subjective time and objective time? And which is the real time? I mean, do you mean by subjective illusory, or what exactly do you mean by subjective?
For example, this work from Shimojo's lab about applying TMS on the hole in the video view. When I say subjective time, it is related to many empirical studies, like those done in Patrick Hager's lab in London, involving sensory motor contingency, like, you know, when you press a button and you see, hear a beep, you sometimes perceive the pressing and hearing of the beep as simultaneous, and sometimes not. When I say subjective time, I'm referring to these empirical data, so to speak. On the other hand, the physical time is the laboratory time with which you can measure the activities of the neurons to, you know, very high precision. So it's very interesting to compare these two different times. I wonder if you are discussing, if you are, you know, referring to these things were more something more deep, or, but you know, that's what I meant to say.
Victor?
You mentioned that the key to understanding consciousness is understanding the relation between neurons that encode features. For example, when you have a V4 cell encoding color, you also have to understand its relation to cells preceding that, V1, V2, etc.
Yeah.
So in that account, I wonder how you would explain the difference between, say, an unconscious activation of that pathway and a conscious one.
That's a very interesting question, and well, nobody knows, do we? I mean, let's see. The idea of homunculus is a very not very popular disease, but I used to study biomedical library myself, and it appears that, you know, in order for a subject to see, you need to have this kind of matching process between the intentional and sensory process, top-down and bottom-up. So, in order to answer your question, how we can distinguish between conscious and unconscious processes, we really need to treat the brain as a system, meaning we need to take into consideration the asymmetry between the prefrontal cortex and the sensory areas. Because these areas contribute to perception, conscious perception, in a very different manner. Then, of course, the question is, what makes the prefrontal cortex so special? That's something very difficult, and I think the kind of approach that, for example, Professor Zinger has talked about this morning, for example, understand the brain in terms of, for example, graph structure, and, you know, describing this graph structure in terms of synchronization and so on. I think by doing that kind of mathematical analysis, maybe we can explain why the prefrontal cortex and sensory cortex play such asymmetric roles. But at present, we don't know really what causes the brain to be so, you know, configured. I wonder if I'm answered the question, but,
as an audiophile and a videophile interested in quality, and if you look across cultures, look at the studies of female faces and people ranking order of beauty and all this other stuff, there seems to be a universal move towards higher quality, or at least, you know, a development of an appreciation towards beauty and art and these kind of things. And you also bring it up with the birds and all these other animals and women, you know, so there seems to be some relationship there towards driving evolution in terms of selection of mates and these kind of things. Could you comment about how there seems to be, you know, is there a neurological or biological attachment or something that ties into emotion that drives preference, this kind of thing?
Well, I think, you know, conservative and very empirical answer to that would be, of course, to refer to evolutionary evolutionary principles, right? You know, sexual selection and so on. And of course, there have been many interesting studies, like, for example, the average face of subjects is perceived as beautiful and attractive. But if you can be crazy, I think, you know, maybe it has something to do with creativity. Nobody really knows what qualia are. And, you know, Plato in ancient Greek times, he talked about this Platonic world and how we are just seeing the shadows of that. And Roger Penrose referred to this kind of idea. In order to really understand the adaptive value, so to speak, of these aesthetics, I think we might have to go to these very extreme, well, from today's standard, very extreme worldviews. But we'll see.
But like in music, for example, if you look at Pythagoras, and certain sounds sound similar, sounds seem to sound
unique. Yeah, sure.
So is there, from a neurological basis, have you been looking at how that happens?
Beautiful things are known to activate the reward system, like water and food. So it's something basic for the brain. And maybe if you're interested, I don't recall, but there was a group in Montreal who used fMRI studies to study music. And their conclusion was that the music, when the subject likes the music, it activates the same reward systems like water and food. But if the subject doesn't like the music, then the reward system is not activated. So it's very subjective, I think.
It's a high order cognitive.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Greg, over there.
Yes, in your emphasis, for example, with treating the vision
as an entire system, are you also suggesting that fMRI gives kind of false identification in a way almost like it's the phrenology of our era?
We use also fMRI from, I'm partly a theoretician and also an empirical scientist, and as an empirical scientist, I can understand why people use fMRI, because that's the only thing they can do at present. So I don't want to criticize fMRI, but from a theoretical point of view, of course, we can say many things about fMRI, but on the other hand, we should be thankful for these experimentalists who, come up with this data. And, as a theorist, I don't know if you are theoretically oriented or not, but, theorists, I think, should be more brave. Because, in a laboratory, for example, if you work to record from a single unit, then you have to spend 2 years, for example, to come up with a paper. But theorists can move very quickly, more quickly, right, So it's the job of the theorists to be brave, and we cannot really criticize the experimentalists for the lack of bravery, because that's not their job. Of course, some people are doing crazy experiments as well, but yeah, we'll see, I don't know,
Okay, last one, Rick Ripley from Mogi.
About the Mach principle, first of all, I think there's some interesting data that was generated by Walter Freeman. You may have had the chance to
see
it, about the olfactory bulb, where for the same odorant that was presented consecutively, it generated completely different EEG patterns.
Yeah.
And this supports your Mach principle. On the other hand, the Jennifer Aniston neuron by Christoph Koch, I think, remains the same neuron.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.